this morning to John chapter 8, John chapter 8, and we're going to look at verses 3 through 11 about the God who welcomes you. As we look at each one of these sermons in this series, we want to encourage you that your commitment to Christ has to be renewed over and over every single day. But at the new year, we like to be able to look at those things that we need to recommit our lives to. So if you turn with me to John chapter 8, verses 3 through 11, you can follow along with me in your copy of God's inspired word. The scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in adultery. And placing her in the midst, they said to him, "Teacher, this woman has been caught in the act of adultery. Now the law of Moses commanded us to stone such a woman. So what do you say?" This they said to test him, that they might have some charge to bring against him. Jesus bent down and wrote with his finger on the ground. And as they continued to ask him, he stood up and said to them, "Let him who is without sin among you be the first to throw a stone at her." And once more he bent down and wrote on the ground. But when they heard it, they went away one by one, beginning with the older ones. And Jesus was left alone with the woman standing before him. And Jesus stood up and said to her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" She said, "No one, Lord." And Jesus said, "Neither do I condemn you. Go, and from now on, sin no more." Heavenly Father, we ask that you would open our hearts and minds today by the power of your Almighty Spirit. Father, that you would convict us of our sin, that you would relieve us of that sin through Jesus Christ, who is the Lamb that died in our place, the sacrifice, that there needs to be no other sacrifice. Father, thank you that you are working in our lives. Father, I pray that you would send forth a great, great move of your Spirit in the coming days. May your word be the pinnacle of what we understand and the pinnacle of the means that you use. Because, Father, we can be emotional, but if we don't have the truth, then we are people that are wandering around. But Father, may you set us on our path. In Jesus' name, amen. I want you to look at this strip here. Today's sermon is brought to you by the Peanuts cartoon. Lucy, as you know, is the one who dispenses psychiatric help and advice for 5 cents. Linus is the one with the security blanket. And there's a cartoon. This cartoon says, Linus says to Lucy, "Why are you always so anxious to criticize me?" And Lucy says, "I just think I have a knack for seeing other people's faults." And Linus says, "Well, what about your faults?" And Lucy says, "I have a knack for overlooking those." You see, today we're going to look at some few religious people that had some of the same kind of knacks. They were able to see other people's faults more than their own. And as we are in this final week of a series that I call Starting Again, it's a series about how you can be restored to a relationship with God, or how your relationship with God can be more enthusiastic this coming year. And so we want to be able to see our lives restored, our walk restored with the Lord as we go through this year. May this be the best spiritual year of your life. Now, what I'd like to say something about this passage, because as I was studying for it, a lot of people will use this passage and they'll say, and they'll look at the lady, they'll look at the adulteress, and they'll say, see, she got a second chance. And one of the things I think is right about that is that we are all given second chances because of forgiveness. God didn't hold our debt to him because he forgave our debt. But there's a problem with this idea of second chances. Because second chances, they're fine and good. But if the chance you have is impossible, what good is a second chance? If you are not able to do something that you get a chance to do, what good is that second chance? It is much like if you gave a calculus test to a kindergartner. Okay? And they get back their test and there's an F on top of the page. But the teacher tears up the test and says, I'll give you a second chance. And she gives the same test again. What good is it to have a second chance if you have no ability to achieve what that chance gives you? Now, it's like us. You know, we're grateful to have that chance, that second chance, that forgiveness, that we can turn our lives around. We can say, well, all that we've done in our life, there's a way that we can change from that and walk a different way. In that sense, we do have a second chance, but there's so much more that we need to deal with that, because salvation not only requires forgiveness, it also requires faithfulness. See, salvation causes us to be forgiven, but it also causes us to be faithful. When Jesus told this woman who had committed adultery that after all the people had gone away from her, he said, neither do I condemn you. But then he said something very interesting. He said, go and what? Sin no more. Well, that was an impossibility. That is an impossibility for you. Jesus says to you, go and sin no more. Guess what? By the time you get home today, you'll have sinned again. And you'll need to come back to Jesus and ask forgiveness, but you'll need something more than just the ability to try again and try again and to try again. To be rightly restored to God needs a perfect solution. And I'm going to tell you today, like I tell you every week, that perfect solution has a name. And his name is Jesus. Amen. And when he died upon the cross, he was our substitute for that sin, so that though we are forgiven, though we can be like that, we have zero chance to follow God's law perfectly, Jesus Christ followed God's law perfectly and not only forgave us, he gave us his works as our righteousness. So that when we are given that restoration with God, that forgiveness with God over and over and over and over again, not only do we have the forgiveness, when God looks at you and when God looks at me, he sees not our sin, but Christ's righteousness. Not only do we have the forgiveness of our sins, we have the works of Christ to bring to God. You see, the Bible says something I think is very important in Romans 10, chapter 2 and 3. He says about these people, it says, I can testify about them that they have a zeal for God. There's a possibility that people have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge, it says. Verse 3. Isn't this in there? Verse 3. Since they are ignorant of the righteousness of God and have attempted to establish their own righteousness, they have not submitted to the righteousness of God. That is such an important verse, because it shows us that we can invent our own righteousness in our own mind to think we're okay. Though we are forgiven, we kind of boast about that we're better than others, right? That our righteousness is better because we don't know of the needed righteousness that we have from Christ. All of us stand either in Christ or in Adam. In Christ, we have his righteousness. In Adam, we have his sin. In Christ, we have his holiness. In Adam, we have his rebellion. And we are guilty because of Adam's sin, and we are righteous because of Christ's righteousness. Both those things are true. Jesus proclaims this, that sinners don't just need a second chance, we need a perfect substitute, and that is Jesus Christ. We need our sins forgiven, but we need something added to us so that we can stand before God without fear. And that perfect substitute, that perfect ingredient, is His righteousness. So when you stand before God, there is nothing that He can blame you for, because He's looking at the righteousness and works of Jesus Christ. You see, we have a lot of things that we can do that, but when we serve God, when we are restored to God, God is the one who restores us. God is the one who welcomes us into His presence. God's grace is available to you today. His grace, as much as you need it, as often as you need it, and as great as you need it, and as long as you need it. You can never exhaust the grace of Almighty God. There is no one beyond who has sinned so much that has exhausted the grace of God. Yes, the Bible talks about the blasphemy of the Spirit. And I believe that is the continual rejection of Christ. Because guess what the Spirit does? It points to Christ, doesn't He? Everything the Spirit does says, look at Jesus, look at Jesus, look at Jesus. That's what it does in our hearts. That's what it does everywhere. In Lamentations chapter 3, verse 22 and 23, it says, the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies, what? Never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. You know, I'm a Christian that believes every single word of the Bible. I'm a Christian that believes every single word of the Bible is without error and is infallible. I believe every single word of the Bible is inspired by Almighty God. And in that passage, it says to us what we could not accomplish, God accomplished for us. It's my hope and prayer that everyone here is able to enjoy, to bask in, to experience the grace of God and His mercy that is new every single day. Why? Because you need it every single day. There's not one of you here that can say, well, you know, I don't need God's mercy today. I'm going to be just fine. Now, let me tell you, you need God's mercy today, but you also need His righteousness every day, because your works are like filthy rags. Your service to God is not commendable to God, because He says it is always tainted with some sin in your life. Some people have a hard time with being restored or being restored to God. They have a hard time with it. Because they, not as it applies to themselves, because everybody wants to be forgiven and restored and be right with, well, Christians want to be right with God. But restoration means something else in their eyes. Sometimes people think that being restored to God means that people are getting away with things they shouldn't get away with. They're getting away with things that, well, I don't do that. And they start judging other people. They have an authority complex, as I would say. They think they're the judge and jury over the rest of the world. Have you ever met anybody like that, that's judge and jury over everybody else? You see, today we're going to look at a story, and the story we just read is about some people who are very self-righteous, by the book people. And They're going to look at that. Listen, think about what this story was that we just read. There was a woman who had been caught in the act of adultery. She'd been caught. There's no doubt about that. And according to the law of Moses, what should happen? She and her husband should be stoned to death. Now, I don't know where her husband was, but she was there. They brought her. But these religious people were ready to see this woman pay the price. And they asked Jesus, what do you think should be done, Jesus? We just want to see what you would do. Now, this is a trick. You see, it was a setup. This is a bait and switch. You see, they were attempting to back him into the corner, because if he had said that, okay, don't do it, he'd be contradicting the law of Moses. But if he said do it, he'd be killing this lady, and they could use either case against him. They were looking for some way to entrap him. And you know what he did? He bent over and wrote something on in the sand. He wrote something in the sand. Now, does our text tell us what he wrote in the sand? It doesn't. He just wrote something in the sand, and they continued to question and ask him, and he would bend over again, and he told them, what? You that are without sin, cast the first stone. And then he bent over and wrote again in the sand. And we have no idea what he wrote against the sand, but I can use some sanctified imagination to think about what he did, because all of them scattered when they saw what he wrote in the sand and what they heard him say. You know, I think that he may have wrote this. Hey man, one of you is an embezzler, one of you is a liar, one of you is having an affair, one of you is a murderer, and one of you is plotting to rob his neighbor. And they looked down, they said, how does this guy know this? I mean, this is my sanctified imagination. I don't know what he wrote down. The Bible doesn't say. But whatever they did, no one attempted to throw a rock at this lady. No one. And what does this mean about starting over with your life? You see, in order to live a new life in Christ with God's grace and mercy, you can't be always judging other people. You just can't do it. You can't be successful in your new life if you're casting judgments on others. You see, last week I told you about Dietrich Bonhoeffer and the cost of discipleship. And here's another quote from that book. He says, by judging others, we blind ourselves to our own evil and to the grace which others are just as entitled to as we are. You can't judge others and walk in newness of life. You just can't do it. You just can't do it. So today I want us to talk to you about what it really means to be redeemed. What it really means to be restored to a relationship with God. So that you won't be looking at what others are doing, but you'll be confident that no matter who you are and no matter anybody else, if they experience the mercy and grace of God, it doesn't matter how good they are. Now, it does matter that they obey God, doesn't it? He didn't say, just go and do whatever you want to. But from our perspective, if they experience the mercy and grace of God, who are we to tell God, well, that person shouldn't get it? Who are we to tell God that? So number one, restored people, and I want to use three nevers. Restored people never forget they receive their restoration from another. In other words, we don't restore ourselves, do we? In our text today, here was a lady who had committed the act of adultery. There's no doubt about that. She's brought before by these people wanting her to be stoned and wanting to entrap Jesus as he was ministering to the people. It reminds me of another story. It reminds me of a man who owed the king we went over this several weeks ago, thousands of dollars, an amount that he could never, ever repay. And the king was about to send him to debtor's prison, and he begged the king to forgive him, and the king forgave him this entire debt that he owed. And then another man came to this servant, and this servant refused to forgive this man anything and put him into prison. When the king heard about it, he became furious and took back his forgiveness and put this man into prison also. And in Matthew 18, verse 32, it says, then the master summoned him and said to him, you wicked servant, I forgave you all the debt because you pleaded with me. And you should you not have had mercy on your fellow servant as I have had mercy on you? If you're looking at other people, I'm going to tell you, the debt that Jesus paid when he died upon that cross, the debt that was paid on that cross was an infinite debt. You had no ability at all to pay that debt. But Jesus did for you. And he gave you, not only did he empty out your account of debt, he put in all the grace and all the money you would ever need. So now you have no debt, and you have all the money you ever need, or all the grace money you ever need to live out the Christian life. So everyone is the same. There was a debt that we couldn't pay. There was a Savior that paid the debt and gave us more than just making us empty vessels. See, if all we are is neutral, if all we are is just, okay, we're going to go about and we're going to try the best we can, that's not salvation. Salvation not only makes us better, not only changes us from going one way to being neutral, but also points us in a different direction, has us go a different way, so that by the Spirit we walk with him. You see, in his anger, the king sent the man to prison where he was sitting to stay until the debt had been paid, which he could not pay. So number one, a restored person knows, and they never forget, that they received their restoration from another. It wasn't because of anything they did. Number two, restored people never build themselves up by putting others down. They never build themselves up by putting others down. I was thinking about this as the people that were trying to accuse Jesus. Now, there's a lot of things we could look at here, but the law of Moses commanded, and it was found in Deuteronomy, the law of Moses commanded the death penalty for those who were caught in adultery, both husband and wife. And so here they are. She's sitting there. She knows her fate according to the law, and people are trying to entrap Jesus. And they're trying to say, well, we're better than them. And so they're actually saying, hey, I feel better because she's not quite as good as I am, so I feel better about myself. But do you remember when Jesus told another story? He told another story about a Pharisee who stood alone and prayed, God, I thank you that I'm not like men who cheat and commit adultery. And I thank you that I'm not like that tax collector over there. I fast and pray and give my tithe. And you remember the tax collector prayed and he says, Lord, have mercy on me. And you know which man went down when they died and was more justified than the other? It was the one that said what? Have mercy on me, right? Have mercy on me. Because the rich man was actually judging other people. He was saying, man, I'm better. Man, look at me. I'm comparing myself to other people. I look better. And I guarantee you, you're going to find someone in this world that you're better than. You just have to look, right? You're going to find someone in this world you're better looking than. You're going to find someone in this world that you're faster than. You're going to find someone in this world that you're stronger than. You're going to find someone in this world that you can do more than they can. It's always the case. Always the case. And what we do is we put others down sometimes. But in Luke 18:14, it says this, I tell you, this man went down to his house justified, I mean the man that asked for mercy, the tax gatherer, rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. See, you have to humble yourself. You can't humble yourself when you think you're better. There is no way you can do that. You see, Thomas Carlyle said this, confess your own sins, not your neighbor's sins. The greatest fault is to be curious of none but the faults of others. If your spiritual defense today before God says, I'm not bad as some other people, you're probably not going to have a great deal of success in the spiritual life, and you're probably not going to heaven. Because you're trusting your own abilities. You're trusting in your own righteousness. If you think that you're better than other people, that's not the gospel of Jesus Christ. The gospel of Jesus Christ causes us to humble ourselves and to say, Lord, man, I only have the mercy of God to hold on to. Adrian Rogers once said this, God doesn't grade by the curve. He grades by the cross. See, what was the purpose of the cross? It was to slay us. Last week we talked about self-denial. It was to slay our own selves. The cross was not meant for us to just hang on and have a good time on. What did you do when you hung on the cross? You were in pain, weren't you? You were dying, weren't you? And eventually you died a horrific death upon the cross. And when Jesus died, the Bible says, it talks about this in Romans, that we died with Jesus because we were in Jesus. Just as we were in Adam, we were within Jesus. And so we died as Jesus died. Our self died. And thirdly, I want to tell you this morning that if you're going to be restored to God, restored people, never, never pass up a chance to pass it on. One day Jesus' disciples were passing through Samaria, and his disciples went to town to buy supplies, and Jesus came to a well with a woman there. You remember the story? The woman came along to draw water for the well, and Jesus struck up a conversation. He talked about her sinful past. She had come there early in the morning. No, she came there in the mid-afternoon, because all the other ladies who had come there probably in the middle of the morning or the early in the morning, and she came when no one else would be around because she didn't want to deal with all the gossip and the talk that was going on. But Jesus was there, and he told her that if she really knew, he would give her what? Eternal life. Water that leads to eternal life, or eternal water. And he pointed out that, he says, go call your husband. She says, I don't have one. And he says, you're right, the one you're living with is not your husband, but you've had, what, four others. But this lady went back and told people because it changed her life. Look what John chapter 4, verses 28 through 30 says. After she had met Jesus, it says, so the woman left her water jar and went away to town and said to the people, come, see a man who told me all that I ever did. Can this be the Christ? And the answer is yes. They were coming out of town and they were coming to him. She told other people, because if you experience Christ, if you experience the mercy of Christ, if you had $1 billion debt, well, let's make it bigger, $1 trillion debt, okay? You couldn't pay that off in your lifetime, could you? And someone paid it off. But not only did he pay it off, he gave you $1 trillion in boot to that. You like that? Would you tell other people what happened? Absolutely you would. Absolutely. Because if you truly experience the mercy and grace of God, like this lady did in our story, when Jesus says, go and sin no more, she was probably going, I don't want to. I really don't want to. I really don't want to. You see, the difference in Paul's attitude and the attitude of religious leaders who confronted Jesus that day. Do you see that different in attitude? I know what it's like to be forgiven. I know what it's like to have someone come into your life and to demonstrate God's mercy. I know what it's like to have to start over. And I know what it's like to depend on a daily, daily grace of God. I know what it's like to be restored to God. And that's how you love God. You don't brag about yourself. You brag about the one who saved you. You don't brag about your deeds. You brag about the deeds of the one who gave you the $1 trillion. You don't brag about the things that you have done for Christ. You brag about the one who enables you to do the things for Christ. You point your life to Christ and not to yourself. You point your life to all that he did and not to you. And when he died on the cross, it was sufficient. It didn't make salvation just possible. He effected salvation for all that he would call to himself. He effected the salvation of us in our life, in our heart. It was him who did it. And he deserves all the credit and all the glory. When you think about the series we've gone through this new year, and in wrapping up this series, the steps to new life, in week one, we talked about you can trust God's power and plan. You can trust it. You can trust him. We talked about the fishermen going into the deep after they had fished all night and put down their nets because they had trusted God has the power and his plan is good for you. You need to know that. In week two, we talked about rejecting your sinful past. If God has forgiven you, why do you bring it up when God doesn't bring it up? Week 3, we talked about you must love first and serve second. You must love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength before you even think about serving Him, because everything you do that is acceptable to God is out of the overflow of your relationship with Him. In week 4, we talked about winning the face-off with temptation, dealing with temptation. And we said you have to keep asking, what do I really need, what do I really want, and what do I really believe? And then today, or last week, we said deny yourself, take up your cross. In other words, you need to keep saying in your life, not my will, but yours be done. And today we talked about how we're restored to Christ. This lady, who probably would have been stoned to death if these religious people hadn't come to Jesus, were confounded by Jesus. Were confounded by her because they thought they were better than her, and they were judging her, and they thought they could trap Jesus into breaking the law of God. But when he said, you without sin, throw the first stone, he showed that none of us has the authority or right to judge and be placed in the judge of others. There is a judge. You will answer to him. His name is Jesus, who is the Lord of all glory. But today you need to realize that if you want to be related to Christ, if you want to be related to Him, you need to seek His mercy. You need to grab hold of His grace. Reach out to His arm and cling to Him. Because He will grab you, and He will grab you up and pull you out of the pit. But you got to be willing. You got to be willing. Heavenly Father, I pray today for all of those willing souls, all of us who are willing to say yes to you and no to ourselves, to say yes to you and no to the temptations we fight against. Yes to you, Father. And Father, I pray that you would continue to restore us, that when we need second chances at forgiveness, we need billions of chances at forgiveness, because we're always dealing with that. But I believe, Lord, that you forgave us completely at the cross, that all my sins were nailed upon that cross, that all the works of Jesus Christ were transferred to my account, that my debt of $1 billion of sin is gone, and my works of $1 billion have been deposited. That I come to you today, Father God, and I realize that I stand before you boldly because Jesus paid it all. I have assurance of my salvation because Jesus did everything for me. And if you're here today and you need to profess Jesus Christ, we want to ask you today to step out from where you are during our song of commitment. To step out from where you are and come forward to let me know that you have aligned yourself with Christ, that you've humbled yourself and said, you know what, there's nothing I can do to save myself. I come to Christ empty-handed. If that's you this morning, I want you to step out from where you are and let us know that. As you say you want to be a candidate for baptism, some of you want to be a member of this church, a partner of this church, and we open the door.